been about 5 months and 1 or 2 weeks since that happened. Been a very, very interesting time. I want to thank everybody who's been watching these worship services online. We've gotten as many as 100 views on some weeks. A lot of people from different places in the country, including donations from one that actually came from California because of that online giving thing that the conference has made available. That'll stay up. I have the camera in the back, and unlike at Greenville, I did push the power button to start recording. So my plan is to take that recording from this service and put that online this afternoon so it's still available for people who want that. You can see, and I can tell where each of you are sitting. You're sitting at the authorized seating areas. You have to stay 6 feet apart. And the masks are mandatory, at least for coming in and going out. If you're well more than 6 feet away from anybody else who doesn't live in the same house with you, you want to take it off, that's fine. But you'll need to put it back on again when you exit the queue. You'll also notice there are marks on the floor, red tape marks. They are 6 feet apart for social distancing. One of the things that was said in the conference recommendations, we have to follow CDC recommendations, annual conference recommendations, New York State regulations. Our opening plan, which was sent to all members, is also taped on the glass next to the front door. Says to try to avoid people passing each other going into the same space. Therefore, when the service is open, I'm going to ask that you leave by this side door here. It will put you right at the bottom of the stairs that you came up to come to the building. That way we get a nice traffic flow and won't be comfortable for us. Bill or Patty was taking the names. That's in the event that contact tracing becomes necessary. There have been several cases of COVID that have been caught by people going to church. And it was traced that it did happen in church. So we're making that out. We're keeping it off. It's not being circulated to anybody. But in the event that contact tracing doesn't become mandatory, then we have that information available. So you don't have to worry about it getting circulated to anybody you shouldn't see. A couple of other things, no hymnals, no Bibles in the pews, you'll notice that. The lyrics for the two hymns will be up here as well as the call to worship and the opening prayer. Hymn singing, can't hymn sing, unfortunately. If you're going to sing, you've got to be a minimum 12 feet away from any other person. I did put into the service a place of meditative music, and Frank had prepared a piece for that. What we could do, if there are people who might like to sing, you've got a musician over here playing, you've got a person standing over there, well over 12 feet, so we could do something like that. That would be something possible. Sanitizers, all that kind of stuff. If you do use the bathroom, this is the only one that's open, the education room is closed. There is a bottle of sanitizer in there. Once you finish using it, spray it. You don't have to spray and wipe this spray. And I think that's pretty much where we're at this point. We've got a birthday and anniversary coming up for Frances. And she said she's like something over 15 years of marriage. What are you up to in marriage now, Frances?
63.
Congratulations. Awesome. I thought I was only 37. And Ed's birthday is tomorrow, you said, right?
Yep.
So happy birthday. We very much appreciate it. Is there anything that needs to be shared? Well, if not, then let us be in an attitude of worship. I ask you to stand and join me in our call to worship. It's our prayer. Our help is from God, who made heaven and earth. Come to worship the one who answers our prayer.
If God were not on our side, we would have never lived.
If God were not for us,
we would have swept out of the world.
God has gifted each of us in unique ways. In our variety, we complement one another. In thankfulness, we bring our joyous songs. We are here to pay attention to God's instructions. Whoops, sorry about that. Technology.
We are here to see what we're concerned
I'm requesting soldiers music with different words.
They built supply cities, Pithom and Ramesses for Pharaoh.
But the more they were oppressed, the more they multiplied and spread. So that the Egyptians came to dread the Israelites. The Egyptians became ruthless in imposing tasks on the Israelites and made their lives bitter with hard service and mortar and brick and every kind of field labor. They were ruthless in all the tasks that they imposed on them. The king of Egypt sent the Hebrew midwives, one of whom was named Sapphira, and the other poor. When you act as midwives to the Hebrew women, and see them on the birth stool, if it is a boy, kill him. But if it is a girl, she shall live. But the midwives feared God. They did not do as the king of Egypt commanded them, but they let the boys live. So the king of Egypt summoned the midwives and said to them, why have you done this and allowed the boys to live? The midwives said to Pharaoh, because the Hebrew women are not like the Egyptian women, for they are vigorous and give birth before the midwife comes to them. So God dealt well with the midwives, and the people multiplied and became very strong. And because the midwives feared God, he gave them families. And Pharaoh commanded all his people, every boy who is born to the Hebrews, you shall throw into the Nile, and you shall let every girl live. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son. And when she saw him a fine baby, she hid him 3 months. When she could hide him no longer, she got the papyrus basket for him and plastered it with bitumen and pitch. Put the child in it and placed it among the reeds on the bank of the river. His sister stood at a distance to see what would happen to him. The daughter of Pharaoh came down from the baby to the river. While her attendants walked beside the river, she saw the basket among the reeds. She sent her maid to bring it. When she opened it, she saw the child. He was blind, and she took pity on him. This must be one of the Hebrew children, she said. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and get you a nurse from the Hebrew woman to nurse the child for you? Pharaoh's daughter said, well, yes. So the girl went and called the child's mother. Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child and nurse it for me, and I will give you your wages. So the woman took the child and nursed it. And the child grew up and brought him to Pharaoh's daughter. She took him as her son. She named him Moses. So she said, I drew him out of the world. Our second lesson is from the letter to the church at Rome. Paul has concluded the doctrinal section of his letter. He now turns to the practical application of the gospel. He first tells us how we are to behave in the Christian community. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. Paul has concluded the doctrinal section of his letter. He now turns to the practical application of the gospel. I don't think I read that book. Oh, and the only reason I did that is because I have videotape evidence of me doing something messed up like that. Well, here's the actual scripture. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, which is good, acceptable. And by the grace given to me, I say that everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all members have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Prophecy in proportion to faith. Ministry and ministering. Teacher and teaching. The exhorter and exhortation. The giver and generosity. The leader and diligence. And compassion and truth. The word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
for this morning from Matthew's gospel. And Jesus has warned his disciples that those who follow the teachings of the religious leaders, while they understand something of the world around them, they do not grasp that he ushers in a time of the kingdom of God. We're in the 16th chapter of Matthew, reading verses 13 through 20. And you may rise from reading the gospel, think for a moment. Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah. The flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against you. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he sternly ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was himself. Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. Please. Let us pray. O Lord, may the words of my mouth meditate in each and every one of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. You are our strength and our redeemer. The Exodus reading is the beginning of the story of Moses, obviously. Now, it says that a new king arose over Egypt who did not know Joseph. You know that Joseph was basically second in charge of Egypt after the Pharaoh. Pharaoh loved him, and he brought his whole family, which was considerable, to Egypt to settle in Goshen. And they prospered there. Goshen was a very wealthy place. It was a land that was, to use a biblical term, flowing with milk and honey. It was a place where people could prosper, and they did. And they grew into a large group of people, a large force. This Pharaoh, and we don't know how many he was after, the Pharaoh who knew Joseph. You know, it was some time because the people had prospered and grown significantly. The introduction said several centuries. That's very possible, but we don't know. But anyway, he looked at this great throng of people and said, "You know what? If one of our neighbors raises an army and attacks us, if these Hebrews join with them, they could overwhelm us because there's so many of them. So we better do something about it." And so this guy, being a despot, did what despots do. And he turned the Hebrews into slaves. The taskmasters over them, beat them, made them make bricks, and build cities for Pharaoh. Monuments and all the kind of things were built in Egypt. And yet the people still prospered. So he did even worse. Midwives, which are the women that help people give birth outside of the hospital, and which was common for many, many centuries, called the Pharaoh, the Hebrew midwife, said, "When a Hebrew child is born, the boy kill him. The girl let her live." And you guys are like, "Yeah, I'm not doing that. We fear God." And so Pharaoh called him and said, "Hey, what's this you're doing? You didn't listen to me." "Oh, well, these Hebrew women, they're not like Egyptian women. They're really strong. You get a call and a baby's come by the time you get there, the baby's already born." So he comes home with something even worse. And the little boy, throw him into the Nile River. Now, I've never been to the Nile River, so I haven't seen it. But I've been to several zoos. And you know what I've seen in those zoos? Nile crocodile. I did go to Gatorland in Florida. Many, many moons ago, back when Turner and I first got married. And I remember going in there. And what they were doing, they fed the alligators. They had a big pail and they had a stick. They hit the stick. And all the alligators would jump and snap. Some of them were missing legs because of that. So imagine what happens to that baby being thrown into the river. Now you've got a guy here who is a member of the tribe of Levi. The tribe of Levi was the priestly tribe. Moses' brother Aaron was the guy who started the tribe of Levi. When Moses said to God, I've got a speaking impediment, I can't talk well. He goes, go, I'll send your brother Aaron to talk for you. Aaron was established as a priest for the people. When it came time for Moses to go to Pharaoh, later on, Aaron spoke for Moses. He spoke for God. It's significant that his father and his mother were both Levites, because he was to become the one that went before God for the people. Priestly function. And so, this child was born, and the child was a beautiful child. Mom and Dad looked at the child and said, we can't go in the aisle. Let's hide him. So they hid him. A couple months. Well, when a baby gets a little older, what's it start to do? Soldiers all over the place outside, you're not going to be able to hide your kid. So they came up with this plot. They took a basket and they coated it with bitumen and pitch, thick tar, making waterproof. And then the basket was taken and put in the reeds at the side of the Nile. And that was the spot that Pharaoh's daughter went to bathe in the river. So Moses' sister Miriam was nearby, watching what was going on after the basket was put in there. And Pharaoh's daughter sees the basket, says to one of her servant girls, hey, go get that basket. Gets the basket, brings it over to you, baby. Sees it's a Hebrew baby. Likely, Hebrews were circumcised. Egyptians were not. So she recognized it as a Hebrew. So his sister comes out in the background and says, hey, why don't we get a nurse for you to nurse the baby for the mom, the Hebrew? Yes, but I mean, go do that. So she went out of mom, Moses' mother. And they took Moses to their home and she nursed him until he was weaned. Then when he was weaned, he went and lived in the palace as the daughter of as a son, a grandson of a Pharaoh. Interesting way to grow up. When I was in seminary, I took a course on the Hebrew Bible goes to the movies. And it was an examination of Old Testament concepts through the lens of Hollywood movies. And we looked at a whole bunch of different ones. And one of the subjects was Moses. And we watched excerpts from three different movies. Number one, of course, was the Ten Commandments. How could you watch Moses about Moses and not watch the Ten Commandments? The second was TBS's Moses, starring Ben Kingsley. And the third was the animated movie, The Prince of Egypt. Three very, very different movies. But each one stayed true to the text. They took dramatic licenses. But they stayed true to the text. Like, for instance, in the Ten Commandments, Moses is in front of the Red Sea. Pharaoh's army is coming, and they're going to wipe out all the Hebrews. So Moses turns around and says, behold the power of God, and throws his arms up and his staff up, and all the stood up in front of the water, held up the staff, and stood there all night, and the wind blew. And in the morning, there was automatic license. See, so we can do like different things there. Matter of fact, at the end, when they leave Egypt, they're marching out for the African Sphinxes, there's a whole bunch of different sphinxes, they welcome all of them. Remember that scene? When the movie was over, or they finished making it, what he did with those things, he buried them in the sand. Can you imagine some archaeologists a couple hundred years from now digging in the sand and finding a whole bunch of different sphinxes out of California someplace? I think that the Egyptians took over North America as well. But there were a lot of differences, a lot of similarities. Moses, Charlton Heston, great orator, when he met God at burning bush, he said, I can't go through the barrel. I don't speak well. Most people interpret that as meaning I have a speech impediment. Because God is saying, brother, how? Well, when Moses, Charlton Heston's version of Moses, goes in front of Aaron, he speaks. Aaron kind of stands behind him as a second. When he's doing a bit with the staff, turning to a serpent, tells Aaron, throw the staff on the ground. Now Aaron, pick it up. Moses is doing all the talk. Again, it's not consistent with the biblical manner. In Ben Kingsley's version of Moses, Ben Kingsley is not the kind of imposing figure that Charlton Heston. Kind of slight, bold. He does speak with a stutter. He goes to speak in front of him. And Aaron steps up and speaks. Again, he says, when he goes in front of the Red Sea, he holds up his staff, standing in front of the sea. And the wind starts to blow, and it gets dark in the front. Then in the morning, starts to brighten up. And you see the sea, and there's a path to the middle. Consistent with the scripture. Not quite dramatic as Caesar, if you will, but consistent. The Prince of Egypt was an animated movie. And in order to tell the story of Moses, in cartoon, it did some things really, really well. One was, now, imagine that Moses was brought up in Pharaoh's palace. What would his relationship be to Pharaoh's son? It's an interesting question. So when Moses goes before Pharaoh, they know each other. They're not strangers. In the Ten Commandments, there's a scene. But Charlton Heston has old Egyptian stuff on, and he's acting as a builder. He has the title of being a master builder. And Pharaoh is lavishing praise on him, and there's a little brittle over on the side, all jealous. And you can see sibling rivalry in the relationship. And of course, later, we'll learn from Pharaoh. And Moses has the audacity to come to him. The Prince of Egypt, very interesting. Moses goes before Pharaoh and says, thus says the Lord my God, let my people go. Pharaoh says, I will speak to this man in quiet. And he gets up from his throne, and takes Moses, and they go in the back room, he comes in the back, he takes his Pharaoh's crown, puts it down, and gives Moses a pair. Brother! I thought you were dead! It's so good to see you! Later on, when God wipes out Pharaoh's army and the Red Sea path closes over them, the water closes over them. One of the final scenes is Pharaoh standing on one side of the sea, Moses standing on the other side of the sea. Same with mine. Three different views of the same story. And each one makes some great points. And most biblical commentators will tell you that the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew and the Sermon on the Plain in Luke are the same event. Matter of fact, the general subject matter is identical. Different wording and different words. But two different people according to some event, maybe according based on the. For instance, if Me and Frank said, now here. In the truck, carrying a stand with a piano came down the street. And that truck ran into a Honda Goldwing. And Frank and I were both witnesses. So the cops took us and put us apart. And asked us to tell our story, our recollection of this event. I can't believe that Frank did not tell us mostly about the style of the other being destroyed by this idiot on the motorcycle. Me? I looked at the motorcycle and said, oh, how could that happen to this bike? Because we have different perspectives. I think that's what happened here, and I think that's also what happened in these three moments. That we see things from different perspectives. Let's step back a little. Imagine that you were a mother in Egypt at that time. You were Hebrew, and you had just given birth to a little boy. An event that should be joyous and full of hope and promise for the future is causing great dread. The law says kids can't be killed. Yet, in the middle of all of that, God somehow worked through God's Spirit. God, Moses' mother, and Miriam, Pharaoh's daughter, to end up doing what God wanted done, which ended up resulting in the saving of the people from slavery, and eventually the line that led to Jesus Christ, the blessing of the entire world that Abraham was promised by God in his line. One of the most confusing theological ideas in Christianity is the idea of the Trinity. And the reason it's so confusing is we don't have anything like it. There's nothing else in our world, in our experience, that is the same as the Trinity. The Trinity is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Three entities in one. One in three, and three in one. All of a sudden, Jesus said, Thomas, he said, show us the Father. He said, how can you ask me that? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. I am the Father of one. The creed that we read talks about that, as does the Nicene Creed. You know, originally in Christianity, there was no common understanding. Matter of fact, the Trinity does not appear in the Bible. There are verses like the one I just referred to that can be used to say, okay, this is what this means and how this fits together. But it doesn't mention anything. Where the idea came from was around the year 400, Christianity was the official religion of the Roman Empire. And if you know anything about Rome, you know that Rome loved peace and order. They didn't like disorder, they didn't like trouble, they didn't like riots, they didn't like any of that stuff. And what was going on is you had different bishops in different cities, in different places in the empire that were arguing over what scripture was correct. One church would be using Matthew, another one would be using Luke, another one would be using John, another one would be using Mark. And they would argue, because things like what I said about the Sermon on the Mount, Sermon on the Plain thing. So there's all kinds of conflict. And Constantine finally had enough and said, listen, get together, come up with a standard list of books that we can put into the Christian scriptures, what you and I call the New Testament, and come up with some common theological understandings. That's where the idea of the Trinity came from. Like I said, it's not listed in the scripture. You can write a lot of things to point to it, but it's not listed. The problem is, again, what can you point to as the same for Trinity? An egg, right? An egg has three parts. It's got a shell, it's got a white, it's got a yolk. Three parts, one egg, same thing. Well, is the yolk the same as the shell? No. They're separate. They're not the same. Okay, water can be steam, it can be liquid, it can be solid. Great. Yeah, but no molecule can be any more than one billion. Why that idea is so confusing. My own way, personally, of coming to an understanding of the Trinity, where I operate, is the Trinity is three ways that God has chosen to reveal God's self to. You refer to the Trinity as Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I know a number of people refer to it as Creator, Sustainer, Redeemer. If the Trinity is indeed three different ways in which God has chosen to reveal God's self to us, then Jesus and the Father are one, along with the Spirit. Now, if you find yourself in this dark place and you're that calm, you can't imagine how anything good can come out of it. You see, your friends and neighbors have their children murdered. Whereas throughout most of history, people would move for a mail truck. And it's the gospel, everybody is. And here, mail trial was something different. God was faithful. Remember that promise I mentioned to Abram? Through you and your progeny, the world will be blessed. God, when he makes promises, he keeps them. He does not break his promise. You and I do that all the time, but God doesn't. And so, trusting God is something that we can count on. We can count on what God is doing. We're still in the middle of a very dark time in our world. As I said, it's been over 5 months since we've been able to gather like this. Normally we get 40 or 50 people in this. 19 years ago? Something like that. Less than 16 people. But we are here. We are able to believe. Because God brings us through. Once we continue to trust God, that God will be there for us, that God will bring us through tough times. And that old saying popped up every once in a while. Tough times never last, but tough people do. You can be tough to God. So I put it to you as we are still dealing with this pandemic and all of this stuff. But trust God that God will bring us through. Now for a while, some of us are thinking, yeah, we'll never get back to the church. Oh, here we are. A good sign. A light bulb. Hopefully we don't go back. Trust God. God will. Our next hymn for humming is Rock of Ages, the first verse.
Thank you.
not going to be passing the plates during this time. Because one of the things they talk about is preventing people from touching the same thing. If I had it, I picked the plate off here and I handed it to another. Now that usher is in contact with it, then when she passes it, all of you folks are going to be in contact. So we're not going to do it. Rather, we'll leave the plate there, or plate there, and we drop it all over again and leave the sanctuary. Just so you're aware, since the beginning of the pandemic, our giving to the general fund, which is the operating funds for the church, is down about 25 to 30%. We have gotten offerings from people outside the church, some from across the country, through the online giving. Providing that that camera is still recording what I'm saying, this service will be posted on Facebook and YouTube later today, and it will include the instructions on how to do it virtually, as well as by mail and other things as well. Just want to let you know about where we're at. One of the things is, we have been using this room, so air conditioning and electric have been minimal. But other than that, the building is still here. It's still continuing. So that's where we're at. Put it on and decide what direction you want to do. As we prepare to go from this place, I encourage you to continue believing and trusting God. God doesn't let us down. God keeps God's promise. You need to look back. Every time somebody finds himself in a tough spot, Stephen as he stoned to death, Peter as he's on trial in front of the Sanhedrin, and over and over and over again, what they say is they recount the stories of God's ongoing continuing love and how God had kept his promises all throughout history, from Abram through Moses through the prophets. Jesus after the present day. So continue to count on and trust God. May you be blessed with hope. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Again, please identify the Son.